So this again is a drawing of the way the Abbey complex of St. Peter and St. Paul at Cluny looked around 1100. It was founded in 910 by William the Pious, Duke of Aquitaine, an ancestor of the famous Eleanor of Aquitaine, and its first abbot was a fellow named Berno. We heard some time ago about St. Benedict, considered the real founder of organized monasticism in the West back in the 6th century, and his rule was the rule, or at least the guide, for abbeys all over Europe for many centuries, although the individual abbeys which used it owed no allegiance to Monte Cassino, where Benedict made his home. Berno, however, brought some half dozen monasteries in the neighborhood under his control, and his successor Odo, given a papal commission to reform the Benedictine order, increased the number of so-called Cluniac monasteries dramatically. By the early 12th century, his successors, Hugh the Great and Peter the Venerable, would rule over a virtual monastic empire of at least 300 abbeys and rank second in clerical power only to the Pope himself. Gregory VII and Urban II, two of the most important popes of the era, did themselves spend time as Cluniac monks. This is about all that's left of Cluny today, a piece of one of the transepts which somehow managed to outlast the wrecking crews of the Revolution in the 1790s. The colossal church, 600 feet, that's two football fields in length, of which this was a part, was begun in 1089 by Hugh the Great. There was a precedent for the Cluniac way of doing things. Back in the 9th century, St. Benedict of Anyan, not the St. Benedict of Nursia who founded Monte Cassino, had defended the subordination of abbeys to a central authority, and he had emphasized the spiritual value of prayer over that of manual labor, which was also to be reflected in Cluniac policy. I guess the idea was, what do washing dishes and mowing the lawn have to do with Christianity, with salvation? We'll hire people to do that kind of unspiritually rewarding stuff. This might, I think, have led some people to join up for the wrong reasons, but in any case, for 250 years, the Cluniac system was a big success, if success can be measured by the number of monks in monasteries. Here's the interior of that section of the Abbey Church now. These bluntly pointed arches are sometimes called the earliest pointed arches in European architecture. We'll hear more about this before long, but arches that are to some degree pointed are not uncommon, even in the Romanesque period, although of course they're more closely associated with the Gothic. Besides the emphasis on the subordination of many abbeys to one and the emphasis placed on prayer, especially in the form of the observation of the hours of the divine office, the abbots of Cluny also thought that it was proper to display a certain level of splendor in the church and in the lifestyle of its administrators. It was in keeping with this view that Cluny was built to be the largest church in the world for nearly 500 years, and as I said, the largest ever north of the Alps. It was this sort of magnificence and the decoration and tendency toward luxury that went with it that came in for the strongest criticism, especially from people like Bernard of Clairvaux, who thought it was bad enough to decorate secular churches, let alone monasteries, and he complained that the abbot of Cluny couldn't go 20 miles without a train of 60 servants. The 13th century granary of the abbey is now used as a museum to house some of the fragments of the once splendid decoration of the church, like this capital portraying a musician from one of the nave columns. Despite the fact that the Cluniac atmosphere and lifestyle were in theory supposed to emphasize devotion and the glory of God, it's clear that there was opportunity for abuse to creep in. Someone says that in religion nothing fails like success. And already in the days of St. Hugh's successor, Peter the Venerable, steps had to be taken to curb abbots who were being tempted to excesses. Peter, in fact, though not officially a saint, was one of the more saintly public figures of his day. He attempted to get the Crusades to take on a more nonviolent, missionary-like character, and he encouraged the translation of the Koran into Latin so that Christian scholars could have a better understanding of their enemies and be able to better refute them. Peter's success at reform was limited, however, and donations of money and property began to fall off as benefactors became disillusioned. By 1300, Cluny would no longer be the force it was in the days of Hugh the Great. Cluniac abbeys were established all over Western Europe, although most were French. This is the former Cluniac Abbey of Saint-Martin, Saint-Martin's, of the Canigou, the Pic de Canigou, up above the town of Vernet-les-Bains, just on the French side of the Pyrenees, essentially until the Franciscan and Dominican movements of the 13th century. Christian monks, whether they were Cluniac, Cistercian, Carthusian, or just solitary hermits, sought to cloister themselves in places like this, away from potential temptations. Their goal was to save themselves, not to save the rest of us, which was the job of the secular clergy. St. Martin's here was founded in the 9th century by the Catalan Count Wilfred the Shaggy, who also paid for the great Abbey of Ripoll across the Pyrenees in Spain. The church we see now was begun in 1094 and heavily restored in the 20th century, but there is still no paved road to it. St. Bernard the Cistercian thought it not only dangerous to look at women, but even to look at the beauty of nature, although it's hard to believe the choice of this site wasn't at least in part dictated by its beauty, as well as its remoteness from other beauties and temptations. Here it is up closer now. Apropos of that, St. Peter Damian says it often took him days to memorize a passage of scripture, but if he saw a beautiful woman, it took even more days to forget her. We've already heard some medieval secular music in connection with earlier things than we're seeing now, and as I've said, things like the Canticles of Santa Maria and the Benedict Boiron manuscripts may contain some melodies and certainly some texts that are much earlier than the 13th century when they were assembled into collections. Also among the oldest examples of medieval secular music are the songs of the troubadours, some of which certainly go back to the 12th century. William the Ninth of Aquitaine, distantly related to William the Pious, the benefactor of Cluny I mentioned earlier, is usually regarded as the first troubadour. He was not pious, though he did fight the Moors in Spain and the Saracens in the Holy Land. William was not a professional poet, however. He was a nobleman who wrote songs for the fun of it. The first important professional troubadour is usually said to have been Geoffrey Marcabrun, and we're hearing a song by him now called Pax in Nomine Domini, Peace in the Name of the Lord. Here's the cloister of San Martin de Canigou now. This song is not a typical troubadour song, however. Almost all troubadour songs are about either war or women. Geoffrey actually says that plague, fire, and famine have done less harm to men than women. Notice the sculpture on the capitals here. That's typical of Cluniac abbeys. The rule is that if you're in an abbey with this kind of decoration, it was probably Cluniac and was at least neither Cistercian nor Carthusian, because as we'll see shortly, those orders allowed no such decoration. Here's one of the capitals up close with some of the monks themselves apparently as subject. I'm not sure what we have here. This looks like what the monks have come up here to get away from, things like topless sword dancers. Here's the restored interior of the church. The short columns below the large arcades might remind you of Moorish Spain, even though the arches aren't horseshoes. And this church is only a few miles from the Spanish border. Mm-hmm. And just down the hill on the French side of the Pyrenees is another former Cluniac Abbey, San Michel de Cuxa. Like Rapal in Spain and San Martin, which we just saw, it was regarded with special veneration by the Catalan Comtes de la Cerdagne. In 1925, large parts of the cloister of this abbey were bought by the Rockefellers and became part of the cloisters of the Cloisters Museum in New York, which you see now. Will Durant says that the overall cultural contribution of Western Europe in the 12th and 13th centuries was equal to that of Periclean Athens or Augustan Rome. And certainly with regard to architecture and perhaps sculpture too, a case can be made for such a claim. One of the most impressive of all surviving Cluniac abbeys is that of Saint-Pierre-de-Moissac, 100 miles or so north of Saint-Martin-de-Canigou and Saint-Michel-de-Cuxa, and it is usually considered to have the first impressive surviving ensemble of sculptural decoration to be seen since the fall of Rome over 500 years earlier. Moissac was perhaps founded as early as the 7th century, but in 1047 it was attached to Cluny by Saint Odilo, the predecessor of Hugh the Great there, and a new, much grander church was then built, only the grand porch of which still survives as you see it here. Here's the tympanum up closer now. The tympanum is the semicircular area over the entrance to a church. It's often suggested that sculpture is reborn as an art form in the south of France rather than farther north because of the presence in the south of classical examples, but this is nothing like anything ever done by the Greeks or Romans. Kenneth Clark says it's so strange it looks Tibetan to him, and he makes the point that it would have looked even more bizarre in the 12th century when it was painted with bold, bright, primary colors. The subject is, in effect, the Last Judgment. The Lord is surrounded here by the four beasts of the apocalypse and the 24 elders as John saw them, as he described his vision in chapter 4 of the book of Revelation. It became typical for the west fronts of Romanesque churches, in fact, to be decorated with some version of this subject. But few artists, whether of the 12th century or later, have created a more imposing image of this episode. This is the trumeau, the post that divides the doorway and supports the center of the tympanum. The crossed lions on it suggest some heraldic or other symbolic connection, but Emil Mal, who spent his life studying this kind of thing, says that he has to come to the conclusion they are simply the fancy of the artist. He found no significant symbolic value to them. Romanesque sculpture, like other things we've seen, such as the Bayeux tapestry and the decorations of the Book of Kells, are full of things it's tempting to try to interpret as symbols, but the bottom line is that not everything in art or history has a reason. Get used to it. On the side of the trumeau is a statue apparently representing Jeremiah, which has been referred to as the work of a Romanesque El Greco because of its elongated, because of the saint's elongated body and limbs. Saints are typically shown looking like they are borderline anorexics. There's hardly a fat saint to be found in the whole of the Romanesque and Gothic periods. I suppose this is because people who are thin are thought to have gotten that way by dint of ascetic self-discipline and denial. Then, too, this sort of wraith-like figure just seems to have something more ethereal, more spiritual about it, I guess. El Greco, in fact, said that Michelangelo told him that elongated limbs would produce the look of spirituality. Here you can see the sculpture in the jambs, the sections beside the doors. At the bottom left is the Annunciation, and is probably the earliest surviving example in stone of this subject, soon to become one of the very most popular in all Christian art. Next to this is the Visitation, and above these two subjects is the Adoration of the Magi, and above that, the Flight into Egypt. We're going to hear another troubadour song, this one anonymous now, called Dulce Solum Natalis Patriae. Here in the cloister is the image of Durandus, who was both Bishop of Toulouse and the first Cluniac abbot at Moissac. Here's St. James in the cloister. And St. Andrew. This is one of the capitals in the cloister, showing St. Martin dividing his cloak with a beggar. The Annunciation to the Shepherds. And this is an abstract example. This is the east end of the Abbey Church at Souillac on the Dordogne River. The facade was wrecked by Protestants in the 16th century, but much of the sculpture survived and is now on display inside the building. And here's part of it now. Although the Virgin Mary has always been an important figure to Christians, around 1100, the position she occupied in Christian thought and the iconography of Christian art began to grow dramatically. A few minutes ago, we saw what is likely the earliest surviving sculpted version of the Annunciation, and the decoration of Souillac here includes at least one of the earliest large depictions of a miracle attributed to her in the story of Saint Theophilus. Here's that part of the work up closer now. The story is of Greek origin, was translated into Latin by Paul the Deacon in Charlemagne's day. It goes that Theophilus wanted so badly to become a bishop that he sought out a Jew who could arrange the sale of his soul to the devil in exchange for this promotion. In the lower register, you can see Theophilus making the deal with the devil, discussing the terms of what looks like a long legal document at the left. In due course, he then became a bishop. But his crime began to haunt him, and he prayed to the Virgin for help. And he then dreamt that she had taken the document from the devil and given it back to him. And lo and behold, when he awoke, it was lying on his breast. Having confessed his sin publicly, Theophilus then died, having been restored to the bosom of the Church. At the top of the ensemble, we can see the Virgin, with the help of Jesus apparently, restoring the document to the sleeping sinner. Despite the popularity of the Virgin, however, such miracles are not common in her iconography. You should remember the 13th century Canticles of Santa Maria, however, which collection is devoted to recounting some 400 of them in song. This is the front of the Trumeau at Souillac now, and it is a bizarre example of what is apparently the Romanesque imagination at its most fertile. Again, as at Moissac, it's tempting to see something more than just grotesquerie here, some code or symbolic purpose, but in lieu of anything concrete on this, I'll have to side with Emile Mal again. The attempt to find such symbolic significance here seems futile. Here on the side of that trumeau is the key moment in the story of Abraham and Isaac. It's not clear why this particular episode was chosen, let alone for this place in the decoration. I can imagine what the sculptor who was given this job thought when the abbot said, "I want the story of Abraham and Isaac, including the angel, in a space 10 feet high and 2 feet wide." That was a challenge, but he pulled it off very successfully, I think. This figure of the prophet Isaiah at Suiak may well remind you of the Jeremiah we saw in Wasak. They look enough alike that they could have been done by the same sculptor, but the elongated, twisting figure is common enough in the Romanesque style in the south of France, and there's no clear evidence that the same guy was involved on both these projects. Neither sculptor signed his name. This is the former Cluniac Abbey Church, now the parish church of Saint-Hilaire in Saumur-en-Brionnais in Burgundy. Saint Hugh the Great himself was born in this town, but the church wasn't built until later in the 12th century after his death. Burgundy was the real heartland of the Cluniac system, and as many, I think, as a quarter or so of all Cluniac abbeys were in just this one part of France, more or less, where, of course, Cluny itself is also located. Another thing now that makes the period around 1100, the 11th century, leading toward 1100, important in the history of Christianity is that the number of reasonably performable music manuscripts begins to increase geometrically. Although musicologists do make attempts to perform the music of earlier centuries, there's much more controversy about that sort of thing, in part because there are just relatively few examples surviving. In the 11th century, Guido of Arezzo introduced the use of a four-line staff, however, which was a major breakthrough in the standardization of notation, and although there is still room for a lot of argument about how liturgical music actually sounded in the 12th century, there is at least a general consensus. And we're going to hear now the Easter hymn Ad Coenam Agni Providi from the Antiphonale Monasticum, while we see some other surviving former Cluniac Abbey churches. This is the church at Berzé-la-Ville, where it is said Saint Hugh himself, the future abbot of Cluny, was taught by the monks. It's especially famous for its 12th century frescoes, thought to perhaps show the influence of Byzantine mosaics, which impressed pilgrims who made their way to Constantinople and the Holy Land after its conquest in 1099. This is the way the Cluniac Abbey, the former Cluniac Abbey in the town of Charlieu in Burgundy, looks today. It was one of the most important of all such abbeys, but most of what remains is no earlier than the 1400s. The Basilica of Sacre Coeur in Paray-le-Monial is one of the largest surviving former Cluniac Abbey churches in Burgundy. Saint Hugh is said to have designed it using the headquarters church at Cluny for his inspiration. This is the former abbey church at Anzy-le-Duc in Burgundy. I mentioned in connection with Moissac that the sculpture there didn't seem to owe anything at all to classical precedent, but the whole layout of the facade decoration, including the Hadrianic-style arch of the former Cluniac Abbey Church of Saint-Trophime at Arles in Provence, certainly suggests the look of a whole Roman temple, and few cities in Provence were more important to the Romans than Arles. This is the cloister of Saint-Trophime. According to legend, following the crucifixion, the Jews put Mary Magdalene, Martha, Lazarus, Maximinus and Trophimus, or some combination of them, or of them and other saints, depending on the version you read, in a boat, and set them adrift. And eventually they arrived on the coast of the Riviera and set out to bring Christianity to the heathen Gauls. According to this legend, Mary Magdalene is now buried at Vézelay, Martha at Tarascon, Lazarus at Autun, Maximinus at Aix-en-Provence, and Trophimus here. The legend is thought to have actually arisen because monuments to the Roman general Marius, Marius, occasionally depicted with his wife or others, were mistaken for statues of Mary Magdalene and various of her companions. Now you see where the great Abbey of Citeaux once stood, just about 50 miles north of Cluny, but nothing here now goes back to the 12th century. The abbey here was founded by a fellow named Robert de Molem in 1098. He had been a Cluniac monk, but wanted to return to what he took to be the real spirit of the Benedictine rule. For example, the monks here were, contra Cluny, to go back to doing the sort of manual labor required in the rule, and their churches were to have none of the distracting decoration found in Cluniac abbeys. The monks of Citeaux wore white as though to emphasize their distance from the black-robed monks of Cluny and the regular Benedictines. St. Stephen Harding, an Englishman, was one of the original 20 monks who came here with Robert de Molem, and he became the abbot in 1109. Stephen is thought by some to have written the principles which the Cistercians were to observe, but the most influential member of the order was also one of the most influential men of the whole century, St. Bernard of Clairvaux. This is the Abbey of Fontenay in Burgundy, which was the second founded by Bernard after Clairvaux itself, which no longer exists. According to the principles of the order, each abbey was to observe the same rules, but they were to be independent of one another, not feudally federated, as it were, in the manner of the Cluniac systems, though the abbots were to meet annually at Citeaux to discuss mutual interests. St. Stephen probably had a very small organization of such monasteries in mind, but under the leadership of St. Bernard, the Cistercian order was to become for a time the largest in Europe. Although he was not an architect in the narrow sense, one of the things that St. Stephen is given credit for is the basic look of Cistercian architecture, a kind of architecture which was to be especially popular, as was his order, in England, where there never were more than a handful of Cluniac abbeys. In this view of Fontenay, you can see the flat east end, which was to become one of the hallmarks of the Cistercian style, and which in England will come to characterize the Gothic style of the 13th century as well. In the nave of Fontenay now, you can see also the bluntly pointed arches of the style. Tourists commonly identify churches with pointed arches as Gothic and those with round arches as Romanesque, but pointed arches, especially as blunt as these, aren't enough to make a church Gothic by themselves, even if they suggest that style. You should also notice that there are no sculpted figures on the capitals, in keeping with the Cistercian emphasis on severity and lack of decoration. If you see an abbey church with sculptural decoration, you know that it wasn't Cistercian, at least. This lack of art is not something the Cistercian style passed on to the Gothic. While we see a little more of Fontenay, of which this is the cloister now, and a few other Cistercian abbeys as they look today, we'll hear a sequence attributed to St. Bernard himself. A sequence is essentially an addition to the Alleluia in the proper of the Mass, and hundreds, I guess thousands actually, are known, but the Council of Trent in the 16th century abolished the use of all but four of them. This one, Light Abundus Exultet Fidelis Chorus, was sung as an addition to the Alleluia for the third Mass on Christmas Day, but it's one that was eliminated by Trent. the point of hearing it now is that it is one of the liturgical pieces attributed to Saint Bernard of Clairvaux himself. Now you're down in the cloister here. This is the former Cistercian Abbey of Seninck in Provence. This is the nave of that church. The east end is not flat, but these arches are pointed and there are no sculpted figures. This is the cloister of Fontfroid near Narbonne. By 1600, the Cistercian order had essentially gone out of existence, but in the 17th century, it was reformed as the Order of Cistercians of the Strict Observance, also known as the Trappists, because the movement was begun by Armand Jean de Rance at La Trappe in Normandy, and these fellows are in charge here now. This is the Abbey of Lathuronnais in Provence. It's also now Trappist. And this is the nave inside. In 1084, the third great medieval French monastic order was founded by San Bruno, where the Grand Chartreuse, or Charter House, now stands, north of Grenoble. Although founded in 1084, the buildings here now are mostly no older than the 17th century. The Order of Cluny is gone altogether, and the Cistercians have had to be reformed, but the Carthusians have managed to persevere through Reformation, revolution, and all the temptations of modern life. Never reformed because never deformed, they say. They were the strictest of all the major orders, living essentially as hermits within a compound. They have only rare opportunities for conversation or self-supporting vegetarians and spend almost all their lives in prayer and study. During the revolution, the Chartreuse was confiscated, and although the order got the buildings back later, it was very poor. It lost all the property from which it derived revenue. And it came up with the idea for a medicinal liqueur to sell. This, of course, is Chartreuse, which is manufactured by the Chartreuse Auxiliary of Lay Brothers, or some such organization. The ingredients are secret. The Benedictines also have a medicinal potion for sale, of course. Here you can see some of the individual cells of the monks. I'm told that there are currently about 35 in residence here. Although Carthusian monks have always lived very ascetically, their reputation for piety has led to some large grants in the building of some of the most splendid abbeys in Europe, and we'll see a couple of them in the future. St. Hugh of Lincoln was one of the more impressive Carthusians, and certainly one of the best Christians of the whole 12th century, and we'll hear a bit more about him in a couple of weeks. This is the former Cluniac Abbey Church of Saint-Foy-de-Conques, south of Aurillac in Languedoc. It is often referred to as a pilgrimage church because it was on the route many French pilgrims took to Santiago de Compostela, and it was in fact a goal of pilgrims itself because it owned the supposedly miracle-working relics of Saint-Foy. These circumstances eventually led to the development of a good-sized town which supplied services to the tourists, and the town today still retains a good deal of its medieval look. As the church stands, it was begun in the late 11th century. Here's the reliquary of Saint Foy now, a girl who was martyred at Agen, says tradition, during a 3rd century persecution of Christians by Diocletian. In the 9th century, a monk from Conques stole her bones, and it was after their arrival here that they then acquired their miracle-working reputation. This is in fact one of the oldest reliquaries in France, and Conques also owns the reliquary of Pepin of Aquitaine, about which we heard earlier this quarter, and which is of about the same date, 9th century. This is the facade of the church now. If the theft seems unmonk-like, there's always the defense that if Saint Foy hadn't wanted her bones to be taken, she wouldn't have let them be. She's a saint, after all. The tympanum over the entrance, made around 1130, is considered one of the finest Romanesque examples. Here you see it up closer. It even has some fragments of paint surviving, although when it was last repainted isn't certain. The subject, as is common in the 12th century Romanesque, is drawn essentially from the Book of Revelation. This is the Last Judgment, with traditionally the Archangel Michael weighing the souls beneath the feet of Christ, while the devil tries, in this case, to push the pan on his side of the balance down with his finger. Here's that scene up closer, and it's difficult to believe that people even in the Middle Ages didn't find this comic. And it looks like the first punishment of the damned down below is to be whacked with a plumber's helper. This is the nave of Saint Foy de Conques now. As I said, this was a pilgrimage church, and the style of architecture common to such churches is often called the pilgrimage style or pilgrimage Romanesque. Such churches are characterized by naves that are relatively high in proportion to their width, something that foreshadows the Gothic style, but they are typically dark and without many windows. They also usually have barrel vaults and radiating chapels with an ambulatory around the altar. The latter was to some extent a kind of crowd control innovation which allowed the pilgrims to venerate the various relics on display by entering the series of chapels on the right, passing behind the altar, and then coming out on the left. Another important pilgrimage goal in France was and is Rocamadour, a few miles south of the Dordogne River. It was named after Amador, according to tradition, the husband of Saint Veronica, who, according to tradition, wiped Christ's face with her handkerchief on the way to Calvary, and whose bones were said to have been found here. The buildings, however, as they stand, are not considered significant in the history of architecture. The primary goal of pilgrims is the Shrine of the Virgin, and it has been visited by as many pilgrims as any other shrine in France, probably not excepting even Mont Saint-Michel. The commercialism of the place, as at Mont Saint-Michel, is often complained about, but I think the atmosphere is not that much different than it was in the Middle Ages, the devout still going up 200 steps on their knees and the vendors selling them Perrier and trinkets at the top. Saint-Savin-sur-Gartempe, east of Poitiers, is an especially interesting former Cluniac pilgrimage church, which was, like Conques on one of the routes to Santiago de Compostela. The church was begun about 1080 and has one of the largest surviving ensembles of 12th century fresco. One of the things I emphasize every once in a while in these lectures is that what makes a work of art valuable is much more complex than just what it looks like. If art were to be judged solely by whether it's beautiful, there'd be no reason to oppose whitewashing the whole of this. Remember Gainsborough called the Bayeux Tapestry the ugliest thing in the history of art? Well, I don't think he'd seen this, or he might have changed his mind. This is Noah's Ark on the ceiling of Saint-Savin. It's simply not true that every age and time produces greatness in all the media of art. In the Middle Ages, wall painting has to rank dead last, and architecture first. The architecture of the 12th and 13th centuries is as great as architecture can get, but it isn't always that way. In the Renaissance, painting will be the most impressive art form. In the 18th century, it will be music. The occurrence of genius is random, and there were no painting geniuses, no Michelangelos or Rembrandts in the 12th century. We would be appalled if this were whitewashed, not because we think it's beautiful, but because it's a souvenir of its age of a kind that exists now in few places. The former Abbey Church of Saint-Sernin in Toulouse is the largest surviving Romanesque church in France and was consecrated by Urban II during the visit he made in 1096 to beat the drums for his crusade. It is also a pilgrimage church in the sense that it was on the road to Compostela and also in the sense that it's in the pilgrimage style. This is the nave now. Like the ones we've seen in other such churches, it's high, narrow, bare vaulted, and dark since it lacks a clerestory with windows. And this now is the way the Cathedral of Santiago de Compostela looks today. According to legend, the body of St. James, which had somehow floated here in a stone coffin, was discovered in 813 by the bishop of the nearby town of Padron, who had been directed to the site by a star, whence the name Compostela, or Field of the Star. It soon became a goal of pilgrims, eventually rivaling Roman Jerusalem because of its supposed association with miracles. The present church was begun about 1075, but the front we see in this picture is primarily 18th century. This is the nave, and those aren't cannons, but rather projecting organ pipes. Okay, that's where we'll wind up this lecture. Next time we'll hear more about the Romanesque in France and also elsewhere in Europe. Then we'll hear about the Gothic style and how it got started at Saint-Denis. We'll have a couple more crusades, and we'll hear about the adventures of Henry II, Eleanor of Aquitaine, and Richard the Lionhearted.